Welcome at the new edition of the Market Reporters. Friday afternoon, Martin, welcome.
Yes, Casper.
Thank you for watching. Bizarre times, lockdowns all over the world, stricter and stricter more. We are in Spain, and today the Junta de Andalucía will
announce further restrictions, I'm afraid. Yeah. And I was talking about it with a Spanish man from País Vasco, and he was actually living in England. He came back because he said he likes to live here in the south of Europe, and he wants to dedicate time to his investment. But he said it's obvious as well, because we saw in America Thanksgiving went through the roof, everybody was coming together. In Spain we had Navidad, we had Nochevieja, and then we have Reyes. So it's three moments that a lot of families and friends are gathering around the table, and you see what is happening.
Yeah.
What do you think? I personally do think that what we talked about this morning, the amount of tests is also
important.
It's difficult to compare the amount of positive people. If you do much more tests, obviously you will have much more.
Yeah.
But anyways.
Yeah, the stock markets.
Stock markets.
We started at the first 3 days, 3.5 days were quite positive.
Very
markets went up
for
all
clients
around the world. Yeah. And also based on the new package of Biden, $1.9 trillion. I want to say something more about it, because I was quite triggered by that new package.
I think
and today Friday markets took one step back.
Not a lot, but a little bit.
But it's also maybe after yesterday the unemployment figures, 865,000 new people unemployed in the US, more than predicted. I think that's why the stock markets didn't move that much, because that was negative news. And of course, normally stock market like packages, support packages.
Yeah,
so I think that was a little bit imbalanced because of that.
And European markets mainly were up because of the semiconductor stocks.
Thursday. So what was in your, what did you talk about?
A couple of things. What I saw, I always like to read the Spanish news, and I saw that Spain is dealing with a very comprehensive package of reviewing the pensions.
Yeah.
And it's necessary, because if they don't, they will not get the support package from Europe. And also the whole labor system is, as we all know, a little bit out of date. So they presented 30 points to the EU. And one of the main points is that the concern of Europe is that the labor system is very old-fashioned. The wages are very low. And also the cost of living is, especially for people that are retired, they cannot live up with the cost of living, because the pension, the state pension is very, very, very low. And also the companies in general, they don't provide private pension schemes.
Yeah.
You know, only the bigger, larger enterprises, but normal companies in Spain, you don't build up pension except from the state. So that is, I think, is interesting to follow. Also, I don't. You see that Spain is doing what they can to get money in the Tasa Tobin. It's a specific tax on financial transactions on the stock market. They were going to announce this for April, but they're going to already start with it from tomorrow. They said literally in the Spanish Saturday, the 16th of January, but there's no market open tomorrow. So on Monday, when you buy a Spanish stock, normally you will start paying 0.2% extra on top of the trade.
And not for all the stocks, no?
56 of the largest stocks with a market cap above 1 billion.
So that's
mainly the whole IBEX 35 and a few other companies. And the main purpose of this is to avoid big drops in the market, because they think, the people that came up with this, that by having this tax, people will wait by selling the stocks.
I do understand that Spain needs more income, and by increasing some taxes or implement some taxes, you increase normally income.
Yeah.
But I think if you say, you must always be honest, and you must say that to the public, we do that because of that, and not saying to avoid.
Maybe it's also because they know that people will not prevent people from selling.
No, because you have in other countries like France, you have also this kind of taxes.
Yeah.
And it was not like in March that the French market went down less because they have a certain tax.
No, that's not completely true.
So I do understand it, and I do understand that you do it on a certain stocks. But in practice, also people will avoid those stocks maybe, and then at the end, it's not a good deal.
No. Biden, no?
Yes. So I was triggered by the $1.9 trillion package that it's going to be in the market again. So I took the I took the time to look back since Obama started, because Obama of course did two terms. He started it in
28.
Yeah, 12 years ago. And when he started, the total debt was $10 trillion.
Yeah.
And when he left after 8 years, it's $20 trillion.
Yeah.
So that it was an increasement of $10 trillion. Yeah. When Trump started, so that was in January 2017, it was $20 trillion. And at the end of 2019, it was around $23 trillion.
Yeah.
23 and a little bit.
Yeah, I had a bit of bad luck, of course, due to COVID, but anyways, it's still...
Yeah, but
Obama also had
in 2020, but he also announced that when he started, he said, "I'm gonna bring down."
Yeah, that was one of his pillars. Oh, yeah. I will make it great again. I will reduce the debt.
And of course, he couldn't expect that, but already before COVID started, it rose with more than 10% because it was 23 and a little bit trillion debt. Last year in 2020, so it was before Biden. The debt went up with 4.8 trillion, and 4.8 trillion is $23,500 per person from the US. Not above 18 years, no, per person. So the debt went up per person with 23,500, and now Biden even, so it's going to the $30 trillion. So the eight is 40% in one term. And it's the fastest growth since World War II, but also, of course, in times of war, with Bush, for example, then it goes up, but then after war it drops
it
directly.
Drops down
and now
again.
There's no reason why it should drop. If you look at the total debt, it's about 100% of the GDP. But if you look at the total, all the debts together, so also the government trust funds, it's 130% of the GDP.
Same as Spain, actually.
Yeah, but that's high.
Yeah, and if you compare it to Denmark, it's 35.
Yeah, 35. Yeah. So 130%. And if how it looks like, it's only going up and up and up. But what does it mean? Another question I had, but I couldn't find the answer for it, is there is a ceiling. The US always has a ceiling on debt. So, but I couldn't see what it is. I couldn't find it. So maybe if you know it, please let me know. Send us a message. We will put our email addresses on it. I think you know how to find us.
Yeah.
Because I think this is also really important to look at it. What is the ceiling? But if you look back 50 years ago, so 1970, of the spending of the government, that was 30% was spent to mandatory spending. So that is social security,
education, healthcare.
Yeah. That was 30%. 30% was also investments. So investments for the country. Mm. If you look now, 50 years later, the mandatory spendings rose with 100% to 60%. So 60% of the income is going out to mandatory
spending, necessary stuff.
Yeah. And if you look at the spendings, that went down from 30% to 13.13%. So America, as a federal state, is investing less and less and less and less and less. So you see, the money is going to a certain direction. And if you look at the
I'm thinking about it while you're saying it, but it's also because they don't manage it. If you need more money in those mandatory things, that's because things are not going well.
Yeah, you can't control that.
No.
You can't control it anymore. So, and the prediction is until 2030, the mandatory spendings will be 122% of the federal revenues. So
that's not sustainable.
It's not sustainable, no. And of course, that's because, you know, the social security system is not really working very well.
No, it's horrible in America.
So it's also, you know, if you look at where you spend your money to, if it's an investment or if it's just a cost.
Just a cost, yeah.
So, you know, those figures, so first of all, are the figures itself, okay, this is how it is, but also, you know, the predictions of the mandatory spendings that will be everything of the income. So what will that mean for the U.S. as a country in a world landscape, competitive wise?
Yeah, it's incredible.
What will that say for the dollar? What will it say for the inflation? For the interest?
It's not good.
So for the long term, stock market's always like fresh money. But for the long term, this is, I think, it's really in a
big problem.
Yeah, I wrote down what does this mean for the position of U.S. worldwide for
yeah,
the long,
no,
long
100%,
future.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, and who's going to take it over if they're not?
Yeah, quite interesting. So
absolutely.
If you know more about the debt ceiling, please let me know. What else did you talk about with clients?
I came across it by coincidence. A client that asked me about what to do with his shares of Carrefour. They're going to be, there's an offer of €20 per share by Couche-Tard, which is a Canadian supermarket chain. The French government is not so happy with it because for two reasons. One reason you mentioned before, which I didn't pick up from the article, was obviously that they are the principal employer. And another thing is that they want to have control over their own food supply chain. No?
Yeah, yeah.
So, and that was actually it. For the rest, no, not much more.
Tesla? And you don't want to talk about that.
I don't want to talk about it anymore. I don't understand it. No, I do understand, but it's so week after week, and people take a short position, and they get confronted with it because they think it's so high, and then there's bad news. 500,000 cars produced. How much left? And then 30% needs to go back.
158,000. The regulator asked to recall 158.
And the price goes up 0.25%. Great news. Yeah. I mean, imagine you have a company, you sell bread, a bakery shop, and 30% of all the breads that you sell in a year or in a week need to go back. You can close your shop.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Now the 500,000, I think it's even worldwide sales. So it's even percentage-wise more.
Yeah. Anyway, so there's
now, positive news, we spoke about it last week. The biggest cruise line company of the world is
Carnival.
Yeah. And they announced this week that they have already for the first half of next year, so 2022, more bookings than in the first half of 2019.
Yeah.
We didn't book.
No,
maybe
no.
You book.
I'm gonna wait to see what happens.
Yeah, but some positive news. So, and that's why the markets, of course, we talk about it every day with our clients. Why are they still high? Because of the outlook that people are really positive about.
That's the main thing.
The future, yeah. Xiaomi, the second largest producer of phones.
Oh yeah.
I got a
surveillance camera of them at home.
Oh really?
Yeah. Probably the Chinese government is looking in my house at the moment.
No, not the government, the army.
Oh, the army.
Okay. That's why they are banned by the US, and they dropped 11% this morning in Hong Kong. So I think better to point it at the neighbors. Okay, so that was it for the next week. For this week, next week, Thursday, between 4 and 5, I will give a webinar about 2021 tips and tricks, but I also look at the main, you know, the big players in the market like Morgan Stanley. What do they predict?
Yeah.
And I try to put my my vision around
it. Absolutely.
From an education perspective. So how can you incorporate certain things in your portfolio? Where are the chances? Where you have to be afraid of?
The next routes, etc.
Yeah. So next Thursday, if you have time, and subscribe. We will put, I think, something in here in the
In the subtitle,
how to subscribe, and then hope to see you next Thursday. Thank you for watching. Have a great weekend.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.